Мы рады приветствовать президиум и наших коллег в зале. У нас сегодня очень важное и знаковое событие. Первая демонстрация возможностей новейшей эндоскопической системы Olympus Lucera Elite 290 в России. И у нас сегодня очень сложная пациентка, которую мы давно наблюдаем в нашей клинике, которая оперировалась 5 лет назад в рамках курса ЕС, которую ведет у нас Роман Олегович Куваев. И сейчас мы коротко доложим историю этой пациентки. И я думаю, что тогда аудитории, может быть, чуть более станет понятно, почему мы пригласили профессора Иновы на диагностическое исследование, и мы очень просим его помочь нам прояснить диагностическую ситуацию с этой пациенткой. Она действительно очень сложная и непростая, и мы надеемся, что опыт профессора Иновы и возможности новейшей эндоскопической системы помогут нам разобраться в диагнозе. Я предоставляю слово Наталье Сергеевне Ведяевой для краткого представления пациентки.
Уважаемые коллеги, вашему вниманию представляется клинический случай пациентки 81 года. Пациентке в 2011 году была выполнена резекция желудка по поводу злокачественного образования. И в течение последних 8 лет у пациентки выявляются множественные плоские патологические образования в пищеводе, которые гистологически верифицированы как дисплазия высокой степени. В 2014 и в 2017 годах пациентке выполнено две эндоскопические резекции и одна эндоскопическая диссекция этих образований. Гистологическое заключение – дисплазия высокой степени. Мы наблюдаем эту пациентку с 2011 года, и сегодня мы просим профессора Харухиро Иноя выполнить детальную эндоскопическую диагностику для определения дальнейшей тактики ведения пациентки.
Now, Sensei, we can start.
Yeah, so thank you very much for your kind introduction of the patient and Dr. Kassin. So nice introduction for us. And we can see Dr. Kalalyov Sensei and also Hyodorov Sensei and Tajiri Sensei. We can see it on the podium. Anyway, so this is a patient as introduced by the doctors. The patient had some Lugol voiding unstained area in her esophagus. So patient actually received the two times EMR, ESD of the esophageal lesion. But the patient still has some lesions in the mucosal lesions in the esophagus. So purpose of this live demonstration is to evaluate patient esophageal condition, and we will do it. The scope we use today is from Olympus GIF H290Z zoom endoscope. So outer diameter of the scope is 9.9.
And Professor, what is the magnification power?
Magnification power is 80 times. It's enough to evaluate the IPCL. Mm. So now I'm trying to insert the scope. The first point is we start the NVI. Always squamous area is the NVI examination is very effective. So this is a uvula, and the so top half of the image is a tan, and then the gradually advanced endoscope. You can see this is a epiglottis. We can observe it, and in the post pharynx we can see it. Anyway, so we cannot identify any brownish area which is a good indicator of the intramucosal cancer of the squamous. So we gradually advance endoscope. Now you can see a patient larynx. The patient cough a little bit, so please add some sedation. Mm-hmm. sedation to heart?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, thank you.
Okay. Let me explain a little bit the situation. Уважаемые коллеги, мы говорили с профессором Иноуэ до живой демонстрации о том, насколько важен осмотр гортани, гортаноглотки и ротоглотки. Это обычная часть исследования в Японии, но в России не всегда уделяют достаточно внимания этому элементу эндоскопии верхних отделов пищеварительного тракта. И, возможно, это является одной из причин того, что ранняя диагностика этих образований плоскоклеточного рака гортаноглотки и ротоглотки у нас находится пока еще не на должном уровне. Sorry, I explained the examination of the epipharynx and larynx.
Okay, usefulness epipharynx. Thank you very much, Dr. Kassin. So once patient started to cough, it's better to advance endoscope into the esophagus. Uh-huh. If we keep it in a mouse, the patient continue coughing. Mm-hmm. So anyway, during insertion of the scope, I could not find any brownish area. Brownish area, it means cancer. So she has no cancer. Anyway, now we are 19 centimeters from the patient incisor, the teeth, front teeth, so inserted then 16 centimeters. And then observe the whole esophagus like this. We look down the esophagus. We cannot find any suspicious area. Her esophageal mucosa has a little bit atrophy. So we call a branching vessel. So one part we will come close. This is not the cancer part, but we can now I give us some magnification. Then we can.
Acanthosis?
This is a submucosal vein, I think.
Professor No, I usually start from the NBI, the inspection of the esophagus from the NBI mode, not from white light observation.
Yeah. No? So we have RCT comparing the white light endoscopy or NBI endoscopy. So which can detect the more and more early cancer. So we have RCT in Japan, and then our conclusion is the NVI observation is much better to detect the early stage cancer. Anyway, so far we cannot, this is a bubble, not a cancer. So we gradually advance the endoscope. So this is a part of now the 23, and the gradually advance. Now I rotate the endoscopy a little bit. So we can see now the 11 or 12 o'clock, we can see a compression by the trachea and the left main bronch goes like this. And the this one, so now the 9 o'clock direction, we can see heartbeat. It's a pulsation of the aortic arch behind the esophageal wall. Anyway, so we advance endoscope gradually. So this is your previous scar. So the patient received that two times EMR, ESD.
This is a scar after ESD performed 5 years ago.
Yeah. So I give a little bit magnification, focusing on the surface mucosa, but no space occupying lesion on the mucosa surface. So we can say this is there is no recurrence from this area, and the behind, but small spot, but this part is not so much. So if there is a cancer, we can see a more contrasted brownish area. Anyway, gradually advance. This is a mucus. This one left 9 o'clock is a mucus. We can flush it out. Okay. And then gradually advance. Now they're 30, so this is the starting point of the middle part of the esophagus. So 3 o'clock direction, we can identify some proliferation of tiny vessels. So tiny vessel is a IPCL. IPCL is the located at the squamous epithelial surface. So at the time of getting malignancy, the IPCL proliferate and more and more emphasized. So in this case, we can recognize some proliferation of the IPCL, and the this part is we can also recognize some irregularity in this area. So to this area, we suspect some dysplastic change. So at this moment, so we cannot say high grade or low grade. But anyway, so this patient has dysplasia.
Okay. What is the type of IPCL in this area? according to your classification.
classification is so complicated. But in my classification, we call this is a 5-1. But mm-hmm. Esophageal, Japanese Esophageal Society classification, mm-hmm. we call this is a B1.
B1, yes.
So still keeps a loop mm-hmm. shape.
Yeah.
So we call Agree. This one the B1. And also the center, this is the... Maybe some mucus and fibrin because of the chronic inflammation. Anyway, so this area also we call this area is a brownish. The margin is not so sharp. Anyway, some proliferation of the dot, Bessel dot, so IPCL. So on the IPCL type B1, mm-hmm. so we can say if this is a cancer, so it's a intramucosal, what I mean intraepithelial, CIS. Anyway, no submucosal cancer. So we gradually advance endoscope behind. We can see some. We can coming back to white light image. This is a leukoplaky. So. Mm-hmm. Hyperkeratosis of the mucosal surface. This suggests the patient has the chronic inflammation. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyway, so far no submucosal invasive cancer. Mucosal surface is has a lots of variety, lots of patches, and the shows different feature. So some part have the atrophy of the mucosa. So we can also remaining mucosa at the whitish patch, okay, like this. So coming back to white light, we can recognize the original whitish esophageal mucosa, but so some of them are replaced by the atrophy of the mucosa together with some inflammation. Okay, so it's like a chronic gastritis, so mm-hmm. similar image. Anyway, okay, we advanced endoscope. So far, we cannot detect any submucosal cancer. So as you watched in a previous demonstration, Lugo staining, yeah. there actually Lugo voiding area. That suggests the intramucosal cancer, but so far we don't have just the low or high grade mucosal change. Anyway, so we are most distal end of the esophagus. This is the squam corona junction. We can observe the caldia mucosa here. So this is a junction, squam corona junction here. And then now we are getting, the patient has the Los Angeles A, so we are coming back to white light. Los Angeles A, not so clear, but this part is Los Angeles A, I think. Esophagitis. Uh-huh. And the hiatus is open. So now we are in the stomach. The patient already receives, we can recognize the patient receives the gastrectomy in the past, I think. So mm-hmm. This is the remaining stomach, and this is anastomosis. This is a billowed second anastomosis. Anyway, so this patient receives the And here we can see ulceration like this. So some bleeding under some stapler, we can see it. So in a magnifying endoscopy, this is a stomach. So I think we cannot find some bleeding, contact bleeding, so once again. But we cannot find the bleeding point is we can evaluate. So last okay. So it's better to take biopsy, but the magnifying endoscopic findings, we cannot identify sort of definite malignant lesion in this image. Some irregularity of the pit pattern can be observed. So it's better to take biopsy, but I think this is still benign disease, but we have to take biopsy, okay, and then keep a little flakes. We can see open hiatus like this, mm-hmm. in a little flakes view from the stomach, in the mm-hmm. stomach, mm-hmm. hiatus is open like this. Then so, and the patient of course received the gastrectomy, so. Maybe this patient has lots of bile reflux. Mm-hmm. When we start the endoscopic examination before live demonstration, we can identify lots of biles in the esophagus and the stomach. Mm-hmm. So reflux of bile juice is a cause of the esophageal...
One of the causes of...
One of the cause, potential
inflammatory
cause,
changes.
Inflammatory mm-hmm. change of the esophageal mucosa. Okay, so the point is here, this is, of course, this area looks a little bit coarse, mucosal surface, and then so come close. For example, this is the...
Maybe ask you to describe these whitish lesions. What is it? Acanthosis or Lachia?
I think this is a combination mm-hmm. of a chronic inflammation due mm-hmm. to bile reflux, mm-hmm. and the now the whitish area, it's the some proliferation of esophageal mucosa. It's like a parakeratosis. Mm-hmm. This is some component of a keratosis, hyperkeratosis, and also some atrophy, reddish area, the atrophy. So uh-huh. combination of both. Uh-huh. So actually, it looks very complicated. But some IPCL proliferation we can identify here. So now the 2 o'clock direction, we cannot identify. Not so much proliferation of IPCL. We cannot. But the rest of the space, mm-hmm. We can see some proliferation of IPCL. So, but the margin is not so sharp. So this is, I think, still level of chronic inflammation. Of course, mm-hmm. when we take biopsy from here, we can see low-grade dysplasia or something, mm-hmm. but anyway, this patient has no squamous cell carcinoma, submucosal mm-hmm. invasive, no. Mm-hmm.
Haruhiro, may I ask you the question about the importance of the assessment of background coloration in areas of dilated or disturbed IPCL pattern?
Yeah. So background coloration is like this. So now it's a mechanism.
Dark background and light background. What is the difference between both background coloration?
So that is a very important question. So in a macroscopic view, not a magnifying, non-magnifying view, we are mm-hmm. looking for the brownish area. For example, we suspect the brownish area here. So brownish area made of two components. One is a proliferation of a vessel. In a NVI vessel RBC, red blood cell looks brown, and also intervessels, there is some non-vascular space. Now you can see it in a, for example, this area, so intravascular space has looks whitish.
Yes.
So we
light,
can say
light background coloration here in this area.
Yes. Then we can say in this area is the background coloration negative. So in this area, not so typical, but the looks intravascular space looks
more darker.
So much darker. So this part is not a typical. If this area has more brownish color, so we can say this is the more risk factor for more tendency to malignant disease. Okay. Anyway, so in this case, we are looking for the some typical background coloration. But we don't have it. For example, this one looks brownish, but this is not. So what I mean is this looks brownish and come close, and then now we observe this brownish area in a magnifying view like this. So we can say this lesion is the atrophy of the epithelium. Now I control the endoscopy tip to observe. So in this area,
because of no any pathological vessels in this area.
Yeah, no pathological vessels.
Yes.
So this
just background coloration.
Yeah, compared to background, so IPCL dots looks same size, and then also we can recognize the green vessels that lands behind the superficial tiny vessels. So green vessels, we can see it. So there is no collection of inflammatory cells underneath the surface epithelium. That means, so anyway, this is the typical findings of the inflammation.
So it is important to assess both background coloration and IP cell, shape of IP cells.
Yeah, that's right. So if the first the detection of the area by brownish coloration, for example, this is a brownish coloration, so we come close, and then look the region in a magnifying. So in this case, in this region, best cell proliferation is not so much. It's a same size to the background, a little bit enlarged, but not so much. So we can say this is a low-grade dysplasia or something, and the background coloration is not so strong. So we cannot demonstrate in this case the typical carcinoma case. We cannot demonstrate typical carcinoma case. So it's very difficult to say, but the typical cancer, the background coloration is more strong. Stronger.
It is important. It was previously described in your papers and in paper of Minami.
Yes. This part we can see some brownish area. So we will approach closely to this region and the magnifying endoscopy.
Oh, also very interesting picture. What is your opinion?
Wait a moment. So we have to get a good image. Okay. This is, I think.
It's not the squamous epithelium.
Yeah, this is the gastric patch, gastric mucosa, an ectopic gastric mucosa. It's very unusual, located at 32 centimeter, middle of the esophagus. But this is the gastric mucosa, not a squamous.
And I think it's very, very difficult to to differentiate a lot of lesions and a lot of different, areas without narrow band imaging and high magnification endoscopy.
Yeah.
It is impossible to differentiate.
Yeah. So you are totally right. Now white light endoscopy like this, it's impossible to evaluate the detail of the lesion. So, for example, now we approach the lesion in a magnifying endoscopy, but we can say it's very difficult to describe this lesion well. But using NBI, we can describe the vascular change at least very well, like this. So this is 10 o'clock area is a hyperplastic. And then, so this side is some proliferation, but I think still the inflammation, not the calcinoma. This region has no sharp margin to behind the mucosa, okay? So anyway, so we spray iodine. So after evaluation of the mucosal surface, we spray again the Lugol solution that makes the contrast much.
Do we still need Lugol solution in era of Lucera?
yeah. So yeah, thank you. It's a very important question. So originally, in the history, we use a Lugol solution to identify the region, but now we have a such a nice NVI imaging. Mm-hmm. So like this demonstration, just by NVI magnification, we can characterize the tissue nature. Then, so, but in order to confirm it, Lugol solution give us more information. So please play. Okay, wait a moment. So now we use a 1%. Okay, so spray, yes, much. Okay, spraying. Okay, wait a moment.
Okay, spray please. Should we clean the surface of the epithelium before spraying the Lugol solution?
That's right.
Is it important?
Yes, very important. Okay, spray again. Okay, thank you very much. So we spray the iodine. Then we can recognize a mucosal surface like this. So some part is the unstained, some part. So we call this the tiger spot esophagus, we call it. But anyway, we can recognize it.
Чуть-чуть главное конец.
Okay. So we can recognize the unstained area here. Okay, so we will evaluate later this region, and then another unstained area here. So this is also suspicious for squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, wait a moment. On the distal part, we have several irregular surface, but I think, this part is, lots of variation of the mucosal pattern, staining pattern, and this is the gastric. Okay, so we are coming back to proximal.
And it is very, very difficult to differentiate all of the unstained areas without narrowband imaging and high magnification.
Yeah, that's right. Then, so this is a previous scar, and behind it, we can see a first one, this one. This one is a low-grade dysplasia. So so cancer is more sharp. So this region is a very, not so much well contrasted. Mm-hmm. Not well contrasted. So this is not a carcinoma, not yet. But this part.
This one. Very suspicious.
Yes. Now I switch to NVI. This is what we call silver metallic pattern, metallic silver sign, we call this. So this is a typical findings of a carcinoma in situ. So this area, so metallic silver shining pattern is the typical findings for carcinoma because of the coming back to our white light image. So lesion area looks a pink. So used to be we call this sign as a pink color sign. Mm-hmm. So this is a sign of intramucosal cancer. Of course, the lesion is totally flat. So this is maybe M1 or M2 lesion. So good indication of ESD, mm-hmm. like this.
But previous biopsies show just low-grade dysplasia. What should we do next? May we ask you to take a biopsy from this lesion in the end of the procedure because the patient is not so highly motivated for the interventional procedure because the previous biopsy showed just low-grade dysplasia.
Yeah, I think biopsy is a...
It's not good.
Yes, yeah, but I think biopsy is... nobody knows or... Uh-huh. It was taken from this area, uh-huh. and nobody confirmed it. And also, histological diagnosis is sometimes it's very difficult. Uh-huh. So endoscopic findings is a more strong information.
Yes,
this is a typical findings of carcinoma M1 and M2. So actually, we missed this region in just by NVI in this case.
Okay.
So in such a complicated mucosal condition, it's better to combine the sequence of detecting technologies.
Yes, so, I see, I understand.
Yeah, so this is the typical mm-hmm. findings of intramucosal mm-hmm. cancer coming back to white light. So I think it's better the patient receives the ESD mm-hmm. of this area. Mm-hmm. That is my conclusion.
Yes.
Other part
to have the big specimen for the histological assessment.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So, Haruhiro, finally,
yep.
What are your take-home messages for the audience? How to detect squamous cell neoplasia? How to examine the esophagus? How to differentiate neoplastic from non-neoplastic lesions. What are your tips and tricks and take-home messages in the end of this demonstration?
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Kassim. So this case has a chronic inflammation of the esophagus due to a previous gastrectomy. The patient, if we perform a 24-hour pH impedance, this patient may have lots of reflux of the bile juice to the esophagus. That is a reason why one of the major reasons why to becoming this chronic esophagitis. So this is a lesion identified mm-hmm. as a pink mm-hmm. color, totally flat, but mm-hmm. strongly suspect intramucosal cancer. So please remember this image. Mm-hmm. We have in such a complicated case. Mm-hmm. We have to combine the NVI image enhanced endoscopy together with a Lugo solution mm-hmm. staining. So so we can detect the high grade dysplasia in the Western pathologist. So this is the option of the mm-hmm. treatment. ESD is a good treatment option for this patient.
And of course, we should start from the assessment of the squamous epithelium in the oral cavity in the pharynx in order to detect the neoplastic lesions in these areas.
So 20% mm-hmm. of the esophageal cancer patient have the oral lesion, mm-hmm. oral cavity lesion. Mm-hmm. So it's better to check the oral cavity as well. But anyway, so this is a lesion. So next step is a ESD of this mm-hmm. region. Yeah.
Okay.
Is that a treatment
Thank
option?
You. Thank you so much. Евгений Дмитриевич, Михаил Павлович, уважаемые коллеги, у вас есть вопросы к профессору Иноуэ по окончании демонстрации?
Ну, Сергей Владимирович, прекрасная демонстрация, прибор великолепный, профессор Иной нам показал очень много интересного. Но у меня вот такой чисто практический вопрос. А как профессор Иной оценивает причину язвы в области гастроэнтероностомоза, чем больная страдает и кровотечение было?
Question from Professor Korolev. Yeah. What is the reason of ulcer in the stomach?
It's another important question.
What is your opinion?
I think potentially we have to take biopsy at the end of this live demo. It's a good.
Михаил Павлович, yeah. Спасибо большое. Это хорошее напоминание.
We forget it.
Профессора для того, чтобы мы взяли биопсию.
So, Сергей Владимирович. Извините, у меня к вам дополнительный вопрос. Делали ей, обследовали ей желудочную секрецию, ТПХ-метрию и определяли ли гормоны, да, так. Не выполняли, понятно.
Да, это исследование. Мы сейчас еще раз осмотрим язву и выполним биопсию.
Yeah, still I think this is the non-neoplastic. But it's better to take a biopsy from edge of the mucosa, so nobody confirmed this is a benign. So, but I think a simple ulcer. Mm-hmm. Maybe this patient has no HP infection, a little bit atrophic gastric mucosa. Okay, wait a moment. But yes, so atrophic mucosa, but the patient age is 81. Mm-hmm. 81. So it's a very difficult to, say anyway. So we take a biopsy from this lesion. So potentially this is a simple ulceration, and the second. So this is the some findings regarding malignant early malignant lesion. That is a potentially maybe a so-called 2C plus 3 used to be, but it's better to call 2C plus ulceration. Okay? Mm-hmm. Yeah, anyway, biopsy? Take biopsy. So we can take a biopsy from this patient?
No.
No?
No. It's yes, okay? It's now okay? Yes. Okay. Previously, no.
Okay. So no anticoagulant?
No.
Okay. So we will take biopsy. So because, so in this ulceration, in a magnifying endoscopy, I still think this lesion is a degenerative change, but it's better to take biopsy from this part. And also the top of the image, we have a bleeding, so we also take a biopsy from the bleeding point. Okay. Okay.
Сергей Владимирович, а вот уточните, это резекция Билирет 1 или Билирет 2?
Билирет 2. По поводу дистального рака желудка. Сколько лет назад?
Окей. Open. Thank you.
Да. 8 лет тому назад была выполнена.
Thank you. Окей. Okay. One biopsy from the 6 o'clock. Of course, everybody knows early stage cancer has easy to bleed. So if we encounter this kind of bleeding, it's better to take biopsy from the bleeding point, bleeding area. So now the bleeding exists, so it's very difficult to evaluate the PID pattern. So now I'm switching mm-hmm. to NBI, but it's very difficult to evaluate the PID pattern. Because of the fibrin or some other. So anyway, we take biopsy from this region. Eh? Okay, open. Okay, thank you. Okay.
И я бы хотел обратить внимание аудитории на то, что каждое действие, которое выполняет японский эксперт, они фиксируются, и уже, уже на подсознательном уровне профессионально профессор Иного каждую биопсию, каждый участок, который он подвергает осмотру или биопсии, он фиксирует нажатием кнопки паузы и сохранением в протоколе фотодокументации, что очень и очень важно для правильной морфологической оценки и построения плана лечения каждого пациента.
So, can we finish the procedure? Okay.
Professor Nova, thank you so much
for this excellent demonstration.